this fucking Barbie car that they've been driving this whole time does not have a top to it. No. So in reality, every single scene of them driving and talking would be
there's a bug in my fucking... Ow!
What?
Oh, we just hit a bug! Ow! We're going 80!
I said a bug!
What?
What?
I need a hospital! This bug
is... Oh. God-awful movie!
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 Welcome back to the Gamcast, where each week we sample another selection from Christian cinema because my OnlyFans page wasn't paying the bills. I'm your host, Noah Lugeons, and sitting 700 miles to my immediate left is my good friend, Heath Enright. Heath, welcome back.
Thanks, Noah. You know what's a great idea for a podcast?
No.
I was thinking a montage of podcasters talking about making a podcast that's a montage of podcasters talking about making a podcast. I'm in a loop.
All right. Yeah. No, we'll see what we can do. And unfortunately, Eli will be unable to join us tonight because he thought that having a baby was like a dinner reservation. So he pulled the paternity leave trigger on the due date rather than the birth date. So he's not on paternity leave so much as pre-paternity leave vacation, but that's fine. That's fine, because we got a special guest masochist to take his place. Thomas Smith is the host of the Opening Arguments podcast, Serious Inquiries Only, and Philosophers in Space. Thomas, welcome back, sir.
Hey, first off, great job getting the Heath playback to make it feel like I'm on the same episode as Heath for once. That's very, very kind of you, Noah, to take my request on that. Also, Marsh, if you're listening. Marsh, if you're listening, isn't it weird that, you know, in this time of crisis, the baby is due. It's kind of, they're in the hospital. They're going to have a baby. Who did they call? They call Marsh?
Oh, shit. The gauntlet has been thrown down, sir.
When it's crunch time. I think Marsh is, you guys keep having him on. He's got like, he's ahead of me by so much. I'm never going to catch him.
Marsh did COVID. We're not bringing him on.
Right. Exactly. As we learned.
When you need an actual smart guy to say smart thing. Okay, I get it.
No, he's saying that Marsh did COVID, as in he created the disease so that he could remain skeptic of the year for another.
Read a website,
you know what?
Thomas.
Or listen to our show, Thomas. Maybe Marsh gets on more often because he listens to the show and he
Marsh
knows
did COVID.com.
all of the inside jokes and stuff.
He's going to be skeptic of the year, just like Trump's going to be president again.
Hey. All right, so tell us, Heath, what will we be breaking down today?
We watched ExtremeDays, one word. It's kind of like, you know, ExtremeDays, but Orwellian? I don't know. No idea. And it's the story of nothing. It's nothing. Yep. There's nothing fucking happens. Yep. I don't know how to talk about this. There's technically some things. There's a group of friends in California. They love extreme sports, and this is like their coming of age story, and it's about watching other people do that, those extreme sports. It's so stupid. It's like if the Karate Kid was just Mr. Miyagi and Daniel watching kung fu movies on a couch, and that was the whole thing, and sexually harassing Elizabeth Shue.
Well, right, yeah, I was gonna say that would be so much better, but yeah, okay. And Thomas, how bad was this movie?
This movie was the worst thing to happen to America in 2001, hands down. Hands down. It's not close. You know, they have those things where it's like if I could take back 9/11 or this movie, it would be close. Like it would be I wouldn't do it if the information was public. Like, oh no, of course, gotta stop 9/11.
But
it's one of those, you know, those thought experiments where like, well, you could push a button, but nobody'll know. I'd be like, how bad was 9/11?
How many people are on the first track again? Which is
Oh, God, I hated this. You know, I thought nothing could be worse than the, you know, overt Christian piles of shit you guys make me watch. But this is worse somehow. Like, it's because it's in the uncanny valley. You know, like,
yeah,
the Christian movies are nowhere in the fucking valley. They're in the earth's core. Like, they're so far from a real movie that you can just enjoy it. But this movie is, it's kind of like a movie. So you're just like,
it seems like at any moment a movie scene could happen.
And it has, I'll get to it. But it also has an Uncanny Valley soundtrack too.
Yep. Yeah, thing. Exactly. Yeah, no, there's the overt Christian movies, and then there's the covert Christian movies, which is what we watched today. Okay, so
this came out in September of 2001 in theaters, by the way.
The worst thing to happen to America in September 2001.
Let's be even more specific. Yeah.
Give me a date. I'll be more specific. Yeah. Give me a week.
This made $1 million.
I know.
Wow.
I saw that, and I was thinking, guys, when do we start making movies? Like, this movie made $1 million. Somehow there's got to be a way that, you know, like,
it's insane that we don't do that yet.
We just need to release a movie right in the middle of a terrible disaster time.
Is that what it was? Like, 9/11 was so bad that people were like, oh, I need to get away. I got to go to the theater. I got to just an escape. Anything. ExtremeDays? ExtremeDays.
These days sure are extreme. ExtremeDays.
Yeah. All right. So is there anything you guys want to nominate this one for being the best at being the worst at?
Yeah, I'm going to go with best worst Bechdel test. And we have some real bad fails of the Bechdel test in our catalog. This one is rough. So aside from a grandma that we meet for like 10 seconds, I'm not going to count that. They have two women in the entire movie. One is already dead of leukemia a long time ago.
Yep.
And the other is a vaginal MacGuffin. She's like theoretically the female lead, but she's the prize for the protagonist winning the movie and nothing else. That's it. Like, they might as well hang her around his neck on a podium at the end of the movie. It's so bad.
Well, so like, in order to pass the Bechdel test, two women have to talk to one another at the very least. We never get that far in this movie.
She would need to be a necromancer to pass the Bechdel test.
You think there's a necromancer version of the Bechdel test? Like the female feminist necromancer movement is like, we don't get the credit we deserve. It's always men necromancing.
So I was going to go with best worst obligatory relationship conflict. Right, because late in this movie, the movie realizes, oh, fuck, man, we're almost out of movie. There needs to be a conflict to resolve in the final minutes of the film. So these two characters that are falling in love have to have a conflict. We don't know what it is, right? Like, we're sitting there through it. We watch it happen. Just to
clarify, we've watched the movie, and we don't know what it is.
Yep. It doesn't happen off screen or anything. The actors don't know either.
They have a script, and they don't
know. Literally, the scene you're talking about, you're totally right. They're kissing or whatever, and then it's almost like an improv game where they're like, no, it's not done yet. Oh, I have to, yes, and I have to go.
Fuck you! What? You have to wait for me to say, you go, you say something. Go, you say.
The director's like, fuck you! Just break up now. Break up real quick. Why?
Yeah, right.
We'll try different takes and just something. Oh, I got to go. You see men and I bye.
Yep. That was it.
Oh, I would like to nominate this for best worst flashback from 2 minutes ago. This is just a minor thing, but for no reason. Like, this doesn't fit with any theme of the movie or anything. Like, artistically, there's a point in the movie where they're snowboarding because, you know, I don't know if you know this, but they're very extreme.
Like,
days, they are extreme. And so they're like, oh, you know, because the fucking schmucky schmuck, dipshit, male love interest, nothing character, vapid fucking nothing.
Literally he's Brian.
Like, exactly. Yeah. Yes.
He's asking the girl to maybe you should snowboard over this fucking jump or whatever. And he's like, I can teach you, like, oh, blah, blah, blah. And then she's like, no, I'm not going to do it. And then the scene ends, you know, essentially. And you're like, okay, well, then she didn't do it. Got it. And then for no reason, in around 2 or 5 minutes or whatever, they're like, hey, remember when I actually did do that jump? And then I, like, punched you in the face about it? And you're like, what? Why didn't you just show us that? It's like they couldn't decide if they wanted to actually do the scene. And they're like, wait, no, we should put that in. We can still do it. It's still good.
We want to do it in poetry, though. Got it. Nailed it. We got a plan.
It was like, because they thought they were being creative. But what it played like is like the script was in a fight, right, with itself. Two people wrote it. And one of them's like, no, she did jump the fucking tables.
Yeah, the editor and the writer are like having a fight. But
yeah,
the
editor went exactly.
Out, like, shoehorned it in. I would say I want to do a meta best worst, which is best worst you guys doing the headings for the notes. Because like normally, you know, there's a heading of like, okay, this is this scene and here's where the notes go. But in this one, because there's nothing happens in this movie, it's like, and now a skateboarding montage. And then I'm like, okay, I have no notes about, I'm not fucking Tony Hawk. I don't, oh, the technique on that.
Look at that varial, yeah, stupid. Yeah,
what am I going to say?
Well, who about, does that?
So then the skateboarding montage ends and then you have another heading. Like I need to do more notes. I'm like, I have nothing. I don't know what's, you guys got a little ambitious with that. There could have been like four headings. I don't know who does that of you guys, but there could have been like four, I think. And there's like, you know, 20 something or whatever.
Oh, yeah. Well, so, yeah, no, there's going to be a lot of in this one. Yeah, no, we're prepared for it. All right. Well, I'll tell you what. There is a ton of extreme sports and action on the other side of the break, so we're going to keep it brief. But when we come back, we'll dive into the surprise Christianity that is ExtremeDays. All right, fellas, welcome to the first ever writer's room meeting for Extreme Days, where we're going to rope the kids in, making them think that they're watching a terrible extreme sports movie, only to reveal they were watching a terrible Christian extreme sports movie the whole time.
Ha, classic. Best way to package Christ's message? Deceit. Love it.
Sure is, Stuart. So, the whole idea is a cross-country road trip for Jesus.
We didn't have the budget for cross country per se.
Okay. What do we have the budget for?
64% of California, some of Oregon, and kind of Seattle.
That'll do. All right. So, what do kids do on road trips?
Drugs.
Yeah. Drugs.
No, guys, this is a Christian movie. So no alcohol, no drugs, no sex, no talking about sex, no acknowledging sex, no swearing. That includes GD and HE double hockey sticks. And of course, no female autonomy. So what else do young men do on road trips?
Not drugs. Hold on. I got it. They stop at gas stations.
Oh, yeah. And restaurants.
Good.
They eat.
Yeah, good. Anything else?
Stores that don't sell gas, they might stop there.
Good. Other store. Yeah.
They have cousins?
Yeah. Wait, what?
Excellent. I think that's going to be enough to hang a script on. Let's get cracking.
How could that possibly be enough?
They fart.
I said we've got plenty.
Okay.
Fart.
Yeah, but they do fart. Go ahead and add that.
Because there really is a scene in the movie dedicated to the main characters farting.
Yes. Yeah, there is.
Everybody.
For real.
19 minutes.
And we're back for the breakdown, and we're going to start off a little cheeky, try to do our job for us a bit. It starts off by telling us that what we're about to see is a true story, but the facts have been changed to make it more interesting.
That's so extreme of them.
That's the funniest the movie will ever be, by the way, this comedy movie.
Yeah. Disclaimer. This is a true story. No, it's not. We changed it to be less boring. Yep.
And yeah, just imagine how boring the actual trip was. Wow. This was the more interesting version.
Yeah, they watched less exciting montages of shit they didn't do.
I really think in the real trip, they couldn't do any of the stunts, which they already didn't do, but like they just sat there and thought about what it would be like if people snowboarded.
Yeah.
Like, hey, let's all sit here and imagine somebody doing a really sick ass jump.
All right.
And then we'll in post.
Everybody in lotus pose. Think about that jump.
All right. So we open up on snow covered peaks, perhaps hoping you'll mistake this for a Paramount production. And then it's extreme. There's snowboarding and running with a snowboard in your hand.
Well, yeah, they're trying to do like a cold open on like a James Bond ski snowboard chase.
Yeah.
But none of them can do it. And 90% of this chase is them like slowly unbuckling, taking the snowboard off, picking it up and running because they're in like woods, not a mountain where there's clearly like a track for snowboards and they can't do anything.
I love too, like, so you're supposed to think that, you know, it's a gunfight on a snowboard. And at one point, some guy eats shit. And then I was thinking about the dynamics of a snowboard gunfight. And I was like, well, that guy's fine.
That was
now,
a really good play, actually.
Yeah, like just do that because the other three idiots.
And that's actually, that guy will ultimately end up winning the the fight.
Because now he's behind him, has the higher ground.
Yeah.
You know, he's all,
gunfights that all go in one direction by law don't really work that well. No.
No, so okay, so what we're watching is this this bullshit effort at a snowboard paintball fight, and they're admitting how little this would work because the guns don't have hoppers on them, right? Like they're shooting 70,000 shots out of these paintball guns. Where are they even fucking coming from? Like the movie admits, yeah, this wouldn't really work, though.
Wait. Are you telling me that the same canned paintball sound over and over and over again wasn't really them shooting paintball? Oh, now God. I feel so swindled. That's most of the movie, by the way. And like, I can't decide if the movie is trying to do like, oh, it's a low budget charming thing. That's why we use the same sound effect. It's funny. Or if they genuinely just don't know how to do sound effects, because everything like this, it's one sound over and over, duh, 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 like the same, and you could hear that it's repeating. God, I hate it.
It would have been better if they just kept all of them very clearly getting too excited and being like, no, but they put in the fake,
did them
whatever.
Moving sounds. Yeah.
Pew, pew, pew. Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
I would have laughed. It would have been the first laugh of the movie.
All right. So we watched this for a very, very long fucking time. And then Will, the narrator, cuts in to introduce us to the gang. Okay, so Will is as generic a human being as you can imagine.
Well, okay, are we talking about Billy Joe Armstrong? Because, I mean, you could argue that Billy Joe Armstrong is a very, I mean, if he didn't have Green Day, he would be pretty generic. I'll grant you that. But I am convinced, this is my conspiracy theory, you know, along with that inside joke about Marsh doing COVID that I'm totally just right there with you guys on. My other conspiracy theory is going to be that Billy Joe Armstrong was actually in this movie, but then he like scrubbed it from the record book. You know, like he just got, it's like, this is a piece of shit. It's not me. That's just a guy who looks like me. And like, don't ever say, you know, cause this is Billy Joe Armstrong. Like it fucking is.
All right.
Just saying.
Yeah.
All right.
Extreme Green Day.
Yeah. And also one of the other guys is fucking Rufio.
Rufio is in this.
Rufio,
yes.
Reveal.
Yep.
And I was like, and I did that thing that I always do whenever it's any sort of non-white person that I think I recognize. I'm like, that's Rufio. And then I go, oh, is it? But should I make sure I'm not? I always doubt, even though I know it's Rufio, I'm like, I'm a racist. I'm going to say something stupid. I'm going to say that, you know, like Sam Jackson was Morpheus or something. Like I'm going to blow it, you know? And so I went and checked. I was like, I got to make sure this is Rufio because I don't know if I got on a limb. And yes, it's Rufio. And you know what I also saw? And I can't... if you're driving right now, stop your car, get in a safe position. This movie has a higher Rotten Tomatoes score than Hook.
What?
Yes. People, for some reason, really did not like the movie Hook. Critics,
yeah, can't imagine why.
Look, it's bad. Hook. It's not a fine cinema, but it's not worse than this fucking movie.
No, it isn't.
It's 28% on Rotten Tomatoes. This movie has 43%.
Oh, wow.
Even the audience score. The audience score in this movie, well, I mean, that's a bunch of Christians, I guess, but it's 90%. Right. And the Hook audience score is 76%.
Yeah, but I read the reviews of this movie. This movie, it was just like, and there was no swearing at all. It was just fantastic. 9 stars, you know.
Anyway, that put me in a bad, real bad mood, though. I was like, come on, Hook wasn't that bad. It's got some great stuff in it. Bangarang, come on.
So we've got
a snowball.
Generic Will, we have Rufio, the ever so slightly ethnic guy that they have in their gang. And then Brian, the ladies man.
Yeah.
And Matt, who is the stoner character. But since this movie doesn't have drugs in it, he's just a California-y guy.
Yeah, that's a good point. He's supposed to be on drugs, but since they can't do that option, he's just a fucking insane person.
Like, yeah.
Everything he does makes no sense. I have to confess something, though. I unironically love this guy. I can't help it. Like, there's something about this fucking, there's something about this John Lennon lookalike weirdo. Like, he's so fucking weird and committed to this nothing dumbass movie that I couldn't help it. He won me over.
All right.
So,
he's an extreme actor. He acted hard.
He did. He tried so hard.
All right. So then we get a title screen that might as well just sit backwards in a chair and sneak the word damn into the conversation, you know, extreme days. And that leads us into this incredibly long backstory, useless home movie shit.
Oh, it was like the Wonder Years, but from the, like, late 80s, early 90s. It was rough.
And if nothing interesting ever happened to Kevin. Right. Yeah.
We also learn here, just out of nowhere, they're like, also, apropos of nothing, my sister died of leukemia when she was like 12. Give you a second if you're playing Christian movie bingo. I think this counts. You can mark it off. So yeah, stupid.
To give you an idea of the joke writing of this film, the dad would have been a good salesman if he just weren't so bad at it, I think is the line.
Yeah, yeah. And I can't even tell if they meant for that to be a joke or if that's just how bad the writing is.
Yeah.
Right. And so they have to show that dad's a bad salesman. So like, here's how he's a bad salesman. He doesn't understand that if you hold things upside down, they fall out. Yeah. What?
He's in the middle of an infomercial just being like, there must be a better way to do. Yeah, oh, right. I dropped the entire vacuum on your foot. It's broken.
Like vacuum someone's head off and then has to bury them and stuff like
that.
You don't need to be that bad at being a sales, like, just show the door slamming in his face.
There you go.
Like, what, that's already,
or show that's nothing. None of this. Don't show
especially
this.
Especially since none
doesn't
of
matter.
This ever fucking matters. You know, this all builds to like 8 minutes. Like, we had a dead sister and dad wasn't a very good salesman. Leads to, we lived in a house.
Yep.
Right. That's what we're setting up here is, well, how did you guys wind up living in a house? Well, let me tell you.
Yeah, we'll go ahead and assume you live in a house unless you tell us otherwise. We don't need...
Unless you tell us otherwise.
Wait, well, hold on. Before you start this road trip,
wait,
you guys,
a minute.
How are you living in a house? I don't understand
that.
Let's
get an establishing shot on a lumber yard, and then we'll go from there.
Wait, you have clothing and you eat food? No.
Yeah, right.
Show me it. I don't believe it.
Food. And so, and then like, as we're going through this long, you know, when I was a kid, back when we got a house thing, we meet all of those friends again that we've already met.
I know.
Oh, and also, of course, we meet Corey's rich grandpa, right? Grandpa G.
Yeah.
That'll be important, guys.
Well, do we know he's rich then? Yeah. Anyway, whatever. Yeah. He's a cool grandpa character. And then he disappears and doesn't matter.
This movie
sucks. And at this point in the film, I was thinking to myself, like, how many kids is Eli having? It's just one baby. Like, I want to back out of this. Like,
right.
You know, like,
even
the first one.
It's not even.
Do you
twins.
Really need me to watch this? Like, how important is this event in your life? I don't know. I started bargaining with myself.
Oh God, this is so rough. And this is in 2001 they made this.
Yeah.
So they're so very clearly excited to be like Christian Jackass.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
The whole thing is that's what we're seeing in the end of this home video is like, look at us. Well, we couldn't quite do Jackass or say Jackass because we're afraid of that word and it's copyright. But we had a very small ramp into a baby pool. That's the same as Jackass, yeah. Right?
We're monkeying around. We're a bunch of rascals.
A bunch of burros. Is that? That sounds weird.
Yeah, and Christian culture is always a good 5 to 10 years behind where things actually are. So this movie is solidly like 1995, you know?
Yeah.
Like, and it's got all the generic rock, as I was saying with the soundtrack. When you look for this movie, it really harps on the soundtrack. The cover is like, with the hit soundtrack, get it for the... They figured like, this is the only way we're going to sell is this hit fucking soundtrack. And then you check out the soundtrack and everything is a slight knockoff of some 90s like punk rocky sound because it's all Christian bands that do like an impression of God. And it's so frustrating because the whole movie, I'm like, am I feeling nostalgic or it's like a knockoff nostalgia? What? Like,
yeah, right. That, yes. Knockoff nostalgia is exactly the feeling I got through this entire film.
I feel it's like a parallel reality that was in the 90s or something. It's weird.
I don't remember three quarters. Charmed kind of life. Was that a...
Yeah.
Is that a thing?
All right. So, yeah. So then we get this little montage of all of these fucking balding 18-year-olds. They want to go on a road trip after graduation, right? They're all in their fucking 30s. And again, because this movie just doesn't have a movie's worth of shit to do, we have to watch them all. We have a little them getting jobs to save up money for the road trip this movie will eventually be about montage.
Yeah, but mostly just to get some racism in there casually, I think, was all I got from
this. Oh, yeah, because of Matt's job, his cultural appropriation job.
Yeah, one of them works at, like, ethnic slur falafel, and he wears a turban. Welcome to ethnic slur fry. We fry the falafel. Blah, 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 blah. Sikh
this
reference.
This is still totally okay, according to us, at this year, even though it definitely wasn't.
Yeah.
No.
Right. But again, like you said, the Christians are always 5 years yeah. behind, 55 years behind on the bigotry, right?
In the parts of the country that we're hoping this sells in, this is still fine.
Yeah. Right.
Which in September of 2001 was the entire country. So yeah. It was fine.
And the worst is Rufio's thing. Cause like he's a lifeguard. Wouldn't you know it, guys? Okay. Let's talk comedy. Let's talk comedy. You guys know something about comedy. It wouldn't be funny if Rufio just applied sunscreen like a human being would, you know, like protect your skin or whatever. That's not funny. You know, he's got to put it all in a solid white, like paint, like it's paint, like house paint on his nose,
right,
just
on
his
nose.
Cause that's what you would do. It's because that's fucking like comedy. I fell over laughing. It's on his nose.
Oh, and then he
rub it in.
He humorously abused children. Afterwards, yeah. It was great. It was like comedy was so good.
Well, and during the abusing children montage, they very, very distinctly, and I bet you this was not intentional. It's just they don't fucking know anything. They used a baby crying for a 8-year-old crying. And as a dad, I was like, that's not the, that doesn't fucking match. That's not the sound that thing makes. Come on.
That was non-diegetic crying right there. Stupid movie. Dumb. Learn your years.
Okay, so they've all got their money saved up. We see all of them doing their jobs. And they've all got their money saved up. And we have this scene where they have to browbeat Matt the stoner into quitting his cultural appropriation job.
Yeah.
Which is insane, right? Like, this guy who's fresh out of fucking high school has a managerial position that has medical and dental benefits. And his friends are browbeating him into quitting it so that they can go fuck around in Mexico for a week. Fuck you guys.
Yeah, and specifically, they have medical, dental, and a full HMO. I'm like, no, that's not how that works. The HMO would be the medical.
Yeah, that's
never mind. It's fine.
That's the M. Idiot.
Those letters stand for things, right? But they're like, but dude, do you really want to do this for the rest of your life? And they try humor again.
Buckle up for comedy, Noah.
Oh my God. So they do this doodly do where he imagines himself as an old man doing the fast food job. And the way that they present this, the comedy that they go with is the exact same thing we just saw him doing, only with a beard.
And then he's going to pretend to be crazy or something. I don't know. This guy, still love him. I love him. I can't help it. It's so dumb.
I'm old now. I can really lean into these ethnic slurs. I feel like you're allowed to at this point, right?
So, yeah, so then he's like, no, I guess I will quit after that doodly-doo. I guess I should quit without notice this job. Okay.
Just start your fucking movie. I hate this so much. I was furious, and that kept popping to my head for the next 50 minutes before they start their fucking movie.
Hold on, Heath. We can't start the movie. You know why? Because we got some more comedy.
We have some packing to do, sir.
Yeah, but the guy is trying to put a full fucking costume shop from community theater into a suitcase and he can't fit it. It's so funny.
They're like, what would be the point of trying to close that? It's obvious it won't hold. You can't put pickled eggs in there.
Yeah. And like, these guys wear more than one stupid fucking outfit. Like, they don't wear those clothes. That's God.
Yeah.
Hate it.
They are not efficient packers at all. That is true.
So I have to point this out too, because there's this moment where like we see them, like they're packing and they're getting everything ready for this big road trip. And at one point, one of them smashes his fucking piggy bank, starts counting up money. They have photocopies of money.
Yep.
They could could they not get the rights to money? Did money not want to be in their film?
Somebody clearly kept stealing the like $8 in change and $1 bills from the like prop room.
Guys, we need this is not your money. That we need this for
I wanted a Twix.
It's like, motherfucker, you ain't paid me for too long. This is my money.
Yeah, my brain went to the like, oh, is this the 30s or whatever? When my, like, you know, like, I was like, wait, this is 2001. Like, what? I know how this money looked. I was there. Like, there's no way. That was it.
Well, and then there's this dumbass scene that where they're trying to pack everything into the car, and we keep getting, oh, well, that's not going to work. That's not going to work. And this scene, like, that doesn't work if the eventual solution is, oh, it actually just all fits in the back.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. No, the answer is we don't want to start this movie, because once we get started, we've got like 23 minutes of movies.
Yeah.
So do everything we can to not, for at a certain point, they're all ready to go. And then they get out of the car and one guy says, for the love of donuts, let's go. Like that.
That's Matt. Yeah. The guy you love. Yeah.
Is that a saying?
I've never heard that saying.
Never heard.
Well, cause they can't say for the love of Christ or for the love of God. Yeah. It's this stupid. To reinforce the point that Thomas is making about this movie's hesitancy to just get the fuck going. At this point, I shit you not, the car they're going to be driving gets a goddamn backstory.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
The Joyota.
Well, because you've got to explain why they're driving a toy Barbie vehicle. It's the weirdest looking. I was like, they're taking a toy car? Is somebody going to be like behind him holding the little control with the wire to it? Driving them the whole way?
It's a Volkswagen The Thing. The Volkswagen Thing from whatever era. I don't know when they actually made that, but that's what they called it.
Wow.
All right. So then they get on their road trip fucking at length. They get on their goddamn road trip. And then we end up with a goddamn location title that manages to be racist. It just says 40 miles south of the Mexican border. I'm like, guys, that's Mexico, or even a specific place in Mexico. You don't have to do it like this, like with in relation to where a real country is.
Just past Arpaio's fence. There it is. Yeah.
It's like their Christian map just has the border and then blackness, like just dark.
Yeah, just number of miles from civilization you've traveled.
Yeah, they're like, look at all these foreigners in this place.
God. Oh, so yeah. So then, they go surfing, and we get the first of many extreme sports montages.
Sorry, do they go surfing?
They do not go surfing. That is a valid point, Thomas.
No, yeah. guys, these characters are world-class surfers and world-class snowboarders and world-class dirt bikers, not skateboarders though, because you're not in a, like, you'd have to, they need tight shots for skateboarding, but everything else, no, these guys are world-class.
Yeah, my note is that person surfing is definitely one of our main characters. And this is one of those places where I had to say, like, I have no note. Just wake me up when they're not surfing. What am I going to, I'm going to riff on footage of the Summer Olympics where some like people are surfing. What am I? Jokes. Surfing.
Yeah.
Watch out for a octopus. Like, what? I don't know. It's surfing. There's nothing.
Guy looks like Kelly Slater fucked. No, he's just attractive. Yeah. That's an attractive man surfing. I don't know.
Wipe out.
I would probably do that too. No. So, okay. But here's the thing though, is that this was really good surfing, right? Like, so like it was ridiculously long.
It was.
I was 100% fine with that.
Yeah.
I would much rather watch good surfers surf than anything else this movie's going to throw at me.
I want to know, do you guys have a dedicated fan base who will do arbitrary shit for you? Because I want, could we take a bet? This was an hour and 29 minute movie, I think, right?
Something like that, yep. Yeah.
Could we take bets on if you got rid of all the montages, how long it would be? What do you think it would be?
Zero minutes, Thomas.
Like, seriously,
I'm going to go, I would say,
like, trying not to exaggerate, it's an hour and a half. I would say it's at least 30 minutes of montages.
I was going to say 68 minutes if you take out the montages. And I might be overdoing it, but yeah.
That's a very fair guess. Fair guess.
But again, it's the movie that's outside of the montages you're describing is a fucking montage of a road trip.
No, you're right. Yeah, well, you'd have to really qualify.
Yeah, you're
it
right.
It depends on how you define montage. Yep. Like,
if you take out everything,
no. If you take out everything that isn't just like two people talking in one reality to each other about that reality and not being like, well, remember when? No, it doesn't. You know, yep. Call that out, we'd be down to like 28 minutes.
Right. Yeah. Right. Yeah.
You could play Yakety Sax over this 90 minutes and it would not be unreasonable. Like, that would be totally fair.
I had a note that was like, is this just a music video? Are we watching Billy Joe's new music video that he then backed out of Billy Joe Armstrong?
All right. So then we cut from the surfing to the scene where they're chugging hot sauce because it says extreme on the label and because they can't have them do drugs.
Oh, hijinks, man. Noah. It's hijinks.
What's a Mexico thing?
Hot sauce.
Hot sauce chugging contest.
What's a four college age dude thing to do? Well, extreme chugging of hot sauce in a restaurant for also no that. Fucking reason.
Great.
Yeah. So, okay, so yeah, they chug hot sauce for a second, but then about 17 minutes into the film, that's how far we are now, the movie goes, fuck, we need a plot of some kind. So Corey gets a call that his rich grandpa died. Remember him from the second montage? Second?
From the home video within the montage of the
right, yes, that's right. It's from the inception level.
Inception of the leukemia plot.
Which was all a dream by Billy Joe Armstrong.
And it's Jacob's Ladder Scenario Podcast.
God damn it.
This whole thing, it's just a movie of bad podcast premises. Like, they just, now they're chugging hot sauce and talking about the West Wing and fucking sucking Jordan Peterson's dick and doing karate. Fuck you. Start your movie.
All right, so Corey says, yeah, I just got a call that my rich grandpa died, but he left me that sweet car he had and a bunch of money. I have to leave the road trip. And immediately, all three of them are like, you fucking dick. You would leave pissing around chugging hot sauce in Mexico with us just to go to your grandfather's funeral.
I have that same note, like, wow, you're really going to leave all this behind? The surfing, the dudes, the chugging hot sauce. Wow, you'd be crazy to leave that for bags of money that you think you inherited.
He's gone. He's walking up the beach.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah. I love, too, the bro attempt at some sort of emotional comfort is my favorite. God, I love how low the fucking bar are for dudes in these things. The guy, because, the main fucking hunk that's supposed to be a hunk is like, hey, you all right, man? It's like, oh, there you go. You fixed it. Good job. That's all he needed.
You've done your part.
You all right, man?
Yeah.
Like, and he didn't like let him go. Oh, his grandpa died. Let him go, have a night to himself. It was like 32 seconds after the call.
Yeah.
Hey, you seem to still be worried about the call. Are you, come on, man.
Should I get you some dirt to rub into this? I don't get.
Yeah. You still chug your fucking hot sauce. We've been waiting.
It's still your fucking turn, Corey.
We're not forgetting it's your turn because you're fucking grandpa. You're not shooting out of this.
Out of respect for the dead, we gave you 20 seconds. Come on.
Well, and then Will, the narrator goes, wait a minute, guys. Actually, now that I think about it, Corey's grandpa dying is super convenient, right? We could just all go to Washington together and extend our road trip.
Because we were fucking out of ideas for this movie until that happened.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, exactly. This is almost a plot, guys. All right, so they decide to head to Washington. So that this could be like it's a cross-country road trip, but north to, or south to north rather than east to west, because that's what they could afford.
But not without the very valuable protest from the stoner who goes, I hate to be the voice of reason, guys, but this sounds crazy. Like, what the fuck are you talking about? This is literally the first non-stupid thing you idiots have considered doing in this movie. Oh, should we drive up to help our friend get money in a car? Or should we keep chugging hot sauce?
Right.
No fucking reason.
Yeah.
I don't know if we have the money to go get the money, dude. they say that the movie gets confused by itself, and then they have to like talk themselves back into the idea that money is made of money, and then we can go get the money, and then we'll have money.
Well, yeah. There you go.
And one way they say, we don't have the money to drive home, we have to keep going in Mexico.
Yeah. We'll have to make a new home here.
And he does a realization like, wait a minute. But if we go to Washington, we'll have money. Whoa. And then they go.
Yeah.
It's like, wow, that was a conflict that I really was invested in, whether or not you would figure it out.
Right. So we have a little montage of them driving for a minute. And then we get the scene where they check into the crappy hotel. But oh, shit, there's just the one bed.
Yeah. We also get our first God reference here.
Oh, yeah. Uh-huh.
The narrator says, God has a way of throwing curveballs.
Pin in there.
And I was like, don't try to sneak God into the fucking movie. Just own it, you fucking liars. Just say God stuff. Don't be all weird and subtle. No.
No, it's going to be another 40 minutes before they sneak him back in again. Yep. Yep. So, yeah, so they're checking into this crappy motel, and they have to have the obligatory, like, you're fighting over who gets the bed moment. Mm.
because that's funny.
And much homoerotic wrestling here. Just constantly throughout the movie, but especially just be gay. Just be gay or don't be gay. Be whatever. But so much of this, they're just like, we're wacky guys. We can't help but tackle each other at all moments.
Stick our faces in each other's crotches. Yeah, no, in the middle of the wrestling and everything, Matt, the stoner character, gets in the bed, takes his pants off and starts wiping his naked ass around on the bed is what happens. Yeah. In this,
hey, you guys, you know, it'd be totally extreme right now. If we all, if we butt fucked each other.
I mean, what?
I'm just saying that might be extreme.
You said that.
Might be really extreme. It's funny.
Can I borrow your safety goggles that you always wear and never take off?
All right. So it's the next day. They're back on the road and we get the stopping for gas scene. Now this opens up with the narrator saying like, you know, there's some coincidences in life that make you wonder if there's somebody up there pulling all the strings. And we were about to have our second crazy coincidence. And I'm like, what is the first one?
I have no idea.
Right. The grandpa died.
Yeah. No, the leukemia.
See, the grandpa died and that coincided with other events that were happening on planet Earth.
Well, right, because like everything coincides, right? So like, I guess everything is technically a coincidence.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, isn't it a coincidence that we're all on this recording today? Boy, that God.
Crazy. Mysterious ways. Why would you let us do an atheist podcast this
weekend? Without God, we would be all doing the show, but at different times because we couldn't.
Right. Yeah, exactly.
There's no way to know without God.
Okay, but to be clear, the second, like, God miracle thing they're talking about right here is that they needed bikes, and Matt, crazy Matt with safety goggles, had a bikes guy.
Yeah.
Like, is that a thing? Do you need a bikes guy to obtain bikes?
Why do you need bikes?
Buy them.
No, they didn't. They didn't. They were like, it was such a crazy coincidence. We were just needing a second extreme montage. And his cousin had some dirt bikes.
And it's so great because I love the Christian entitlement of this movie and the male. If there's a good, you know, like to use the word we were just using, a good coincidence of Christian entitlement and male entitlement in this movie that just, it's so good. Because the people, the main characters are just total pieces of shit.
Horrible.
And like, but you still love them. It's like, do you?
No.
Do you? Because as the narrator is saying, oh, you know, those coincidences, they are about to commit vehicular homicide. Like they are literally, run over somebody. I think it's like a homeless person.
Yeah, they run over the homeless guy's shopping cart. Yeah.
They run over a homeless guy's shopping cart.
So close to murder.
Not even addressed. They're like, oh, you're not a person. We don't give a fuck about you. Pull yourself by your bootstraps. There's no, I'm pretty sure Jesus didn't say anything about helping the poor. So you are not a character.
Well, and so here's how stupid the coincidence though is in this movie, right? So the real coincidence they're talking about is they're about to meet this girl. They're about to meet the love interest. They were heading to meet her. She's the cousin with the bikes, right? Like the coincidence is that the person that they were coming to see was in the place they went to see her.
Well, it's the guys who are the other cousins who are own the mechanic shop.
Because the joke is that everyone in this town is somehow Matt's cousin.
Right.
I don't even understand the punchline. Is that a joke? What's the joke?
Ugh, so bad. But she does enter with her like attractive woman music.
Yes, the slow motion entry. Yeah. Uh-huh.
I wanted them to stop and be like, hey, did that woman have a soundtrack when she walked out just now? Like entry to the WWE music. Yeah. But then Brian, who we decide right now is the protagonist, I guess. He becomes the protagonist here. He's just like, hello, damsel, I have a penis. I'll fix your car. Mm-hmm. Yep. And she's like, please go away now. And he's like, it's 2001. I'm allowed to harass you forever.
I will not. And it's charming.
I heard your no, and I choose to ignore it. And I am the hero of this film.
Yep. So what we're getting here is that the love interest girl has shown up at the repair shop. Her car's broken down. How will she ever get to Seattle? Well, wouldn't you know it? That's where they're going to. See, there's your coincidence.
Mm. You guys.
Clever.
You guys want to invite her into our montage? Let's invite her into our montage.
All right, well, I'll tell you what. We've made it far enough to meet the love interest that this movie will later try to have been about, so we've earned ourselves a break, but we'll be back soon with even more Extreme Days. All right, so for this next scene, the whole crew are checking into a crappy motel, but hey, there's just one bed.
Classic. Just oh, one.
Good stuff.
All right, so we fight over who gets the bed, I'm assuming.
Yeah, right. I was thinking you guys could wrestle for it, right?
Wrestle?
Yeah, no, you guys could just all like get together and wrap your arms over each other, roll around on the bed, just grab each other by, you know, whatever you can get a hold of and squeeze just in a huge pile of young man meat. You know what I mean?
Do you want us to cuddle for
aggressive? Cuddle? No, this is a Christian movie. Okay, I want you to heterosexually wrestle.
Okay.
Matt, your first thing, though, you're going to get under the covers. You're going to take off your pants and your underwear and then just writhe around on the bed.
You want me to writhe?
Yes.
Heterosexually?
Of course.
Okay, and then what after that?
I was thinking you could heterosexually suck each other's dicks. And we're back for more of this shit. And since it's been a while since this movie was extreme, we're going to open up on a random dirt biking montage.
Yep.
And these are definitely our actors doing this because you can cover those stuntmen from head to toe.
Absolutely not. This is, again, just stock footage. It's like they might as well just stop to watch YouTube videos together.
Yeah.
And we watch them watch YouTube videos.
I had the same thought. I was like, this movie would never happen now because we all have YouTube. And so you'd just be like, why would I watch this piece of shit when I could just go to the YouTube clips? But back then, you know, they probably had to track down these VHS tapes to like get it into the
well,
movie.
Yeah, no, that was the thing though, right? Like you would suffer through the fucking plot because you were like, ah, but there is some good surfing in there somewhere. Yeah, yeah, right. Right.
You know what's also cool besides surfing that we can't do ourselves? Extreme dirt biking. Let's watch other people do that.
What I love about this scene is the voiceover says, Jesse made her conditions clear. And I just assumed her conditions were, you guys had better get some sick air on these bikes. Like, cut to them getting some totally ill air on these jumps.
And check, Jesse. You're welcome.
Yeah, right.
Yeah. I wanted her to like point out what the fuck was happening though. Just being like, hey, are we stopping every so often on the road trip for a montage within like the random breaks? It's slowing down the trip. Guys, just, you know, let's drive and we'll watch YouTube videos.
Yeah, I wanted Corey to go off at some point and go like, guys, I'm trying to get to my grandfather's funeral here. This is like a dream.
Hey, 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 hey. Respect the montage, Corey. Fuck you.
This is also features the kind of fucking bullshit 90s rock punk thing song where you don't, I guess if you're like a one-armed guitar player, you can just capo a power chord onto the guitar and then it's just da-dam, da-da-dam, dam,
yep,
dam, da-da-dam, dam, dam. That's one fucking power chord. The whole song is that. Da-dam, da-dam, dam, da-dam. God, I hate it. I hate it so much.
All right, so then we get the fucking bet, right? See, because dirt biking air or no, Jesse still doesn't want to fuck Brian. So now Corey is going to make a bet. Now, in a normal goddamn movie, this would be a $100 bet that she wouldn't fuck him during the road trip, right? But they can say fuck or reference the idea of fucking or acknowledge that other people once referenced the idea of fucking. So they end up with this convoluted shit where Corey bets him $100, bets Brian, the ladies man, $100 that she won't, quote, do something she's never done before that he wants her to do that scares her.
I bet you can't coerce this woman into doing something non-consensual. Not sex is what I mean, but something terrible. What the fuck?
That's the bet. Now, much of this movie is going to revolve around them forgetting and then remembering about that this bet is a thing, right? So, okay. After that, they stop for food. And Brian just turns to Jesse and says, hey, you know, apropos of nothing, are you scared of anything I could coerce you into doing?
And she's like, please stop talking to me. Don't address me directly at all. I would like you to not talk to
me. And then he takes that as a bidding war.
Yep.
Oh, you don't want to talk? $10. Do I hear 15? Talk to me for $15. Time $20. Try $20. It's like, this is your main character. And she even says, quote, you don't really understand what the word no means, do you? And
yep.
The movie's like, lovable that guy.
Yes.
Awful.
Yeah. And yeah, we establish here, first of all, we establish that she's going to Yale, but don't worry, she's paying her own way to Yale in 2001. And also we established that she's terrified to sing in public. So if he could convince her to sing in public, that would win him the bet.
Yep.
So that's when the bidding war starts. He's like, okay, I'll give you $10 to sing in public, $15, $25, $50, $99.93, right? I'm like, hey, man, why don't you just give her a fucking leash and some cymbals?
God.
But she manages to turn this around on him. She says, I'll tell you what, I'll make a bet with you. Loser has to sing in public. And I'm like, oh, good. We're inceptioning the bets now. And this is where they play their rousing game of whack me in the head with a mouth spoon.
I hate this so much. I hate this so much. Every single part of this I hate.
So here's the thing. This is fine if they do it once. The problem is that they keep doing this goddamn joke so long after the punchline that, like, you go and get a fucking drink and a sandwich.
Oh, if you took out montages plus this stupid fucking diner scene, we're down to 12 minutes of remaining movie.
All right, so here's the bit. So she says, here's the game. It's called spoons. You try to whack me in the head as hard as you can with a spoon in your mouth. And I'll do the same. And then loser is the person who has to give up first. But it's all a trick, see, because cousin Matt the stoner is going to stand behind Brian and whack him in the head with a spoon. Yeah. Get it?
And you think, oh, is he going to figure it out? No, he's not going to figure it out. And furthermore, it will somehow not be a turnoff for her that he's a fucking idiot who never figured out this game. And like, he's still, the end of the movie, he could still be like, all right, one more shot at your head. I want to hit you in the head, just put one more time. Lovable that guy.
So,
I don't remember his fucking name. Who cares? They're all the same fucking schmuck.
And again, like, you know, look, if they did it once and then tee hee hee and later reference, man, you know, if, and he said later, like, yeah, my head still hurts. Never figured out 11 times in how you were getting such a hard, you know, then maybe that's fine. Okay. You did your joke right. But they just keep going with it over and over. And you're like, yeah, is Matt going to hit him in the fucking head? Well, of course he's, we've seen this already.
And then the whole diner is interested in this stupid fucking thing. Oh, we don't all have lives of our own.
Nope.
We definitely care about what these fucking idiot college Christians are doing because it's so wacky. It's extreme. We're drawn to extreme things. What can we say? The whole town comes in. Hey, did you hear there's some
There's people, spoon whacking going spoon on whacking down at Cadillac Jack's.
Spoons, 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 spoons.
The mayor comes in. I hear you're playing a game of spoons. I hereby declare that you mayor of the they give the key to the city. Yeah, it's like, come on, nobody would care about this.
So finally, like, he gives up and he has to sing, and then they all go to leave, and he turns to Will, to the narrator, right? And he says, man, Jesse sure is awesome. She reminds me of Dead Leukemia Sister. Remember? That had a purpose. Dead Leukemia Sister from the beginning. Nailed it.
Yeah, what I look for in a woman is for them to remind me of my sister.
That's
what I want. Really want that.
All right, so now we're going to move on to San Francisco. We're going to watch them tourist about on the Golden Gate Bridge just long enough for us to all write in our notes, oh my God, I'm watching someone else's home movies.
Oh no, see, I have the best possible thing this movie could do right now would be to cut straight into the Full House intro right now. On the bridge, just fucking abandon whatever you were doing and just go into that. Yeah.
But they go to San Francisco and they're like, all right, San Francisco, such a cool city. You guys want to stand on the middle of a bridge? They have a fucking bridge here. Bridge. We'll stand there in the middle of the bridge, and that's what they do.
No other city has bridges.
Nope. That's the bridge, America's bridge. And here's the fucked up thing about this bridge scene, right? We see the fucking shaky cam home footage shit they keep sneaking in of them all being on the bridge. And then we get this helicopter shot, right? They didn't have fucking drones to do this back then. They were using the goddamn helicopter where we pan away from them out into the bay and everything. And I'm like, my fucking God, a helicopter was involved in making this piece of shit movie. That's sad.
That's where the whole budget went to that. one thing.
Yep. Well, yeah, right.
An extreme helicopter montage for a second.
Well, and then after the fucking bridge scene, some local skateboarders hooked him up with a skateboarding montage. Yeah.
Wow, all their legs are really good at skateboarding. Definitely. Look at all the main characters' legs.
They couldn't even talk the goddamn stuntman into wearing normal pants like the rest of them were wearing. He's got the baggy-ass skater pants. I'm like, oh, wow, did they change pants before they went skating?
No, they definitely went to a skate park, didn't tell anyone they were filming, and just shot close-ups of all the skaters' legs.
Yep.
And then where they're like, this is our movie.
Hey man, you're right next to my legs. What the fuck are you doing? Stop.
I love this. Of all the ass down montages I've ever seen, this might be my favorite. Okay, so it's in the top 10. In the top 10. All right, and by the way, I want to say we're about 25 seconds into that montage before I catch him reusing the same shot. So that too. But now it's time for a fart montage. You think I'm kidding. The audience thinks I'm fucking kidding. The audience thinks there's not really a fart montage at this point in the goddamn movie. But this is. The fucking movie comes up. We get a little title card that says 5:43 a.m. And all of the main characters are sitting around in the hotel room lighting their farts on fire together. But they're not using a lighter. Right? There's no lighter or candle or match. They just fart and fire shoots out of their ass like they're a reverse dragon.
I think we're to believe they all have an ignition system in their sphincters. Like, you know, okay, we all shove the igniter up our assholes, right?
Yeah.
Yep. Start the montage.
Yep. We all did that just now for today only. Correct. That's why I did it just now.
Hey, I noticed you didn't go into the bathroom to install
your... I did it when you weren't looking just a second ago.
Really? Well, guys were in the bathroom. I inserted in my ass splint.
Yep. Because mine involved a lot of work. I had to squat. I didn't see you do any of that. Weird.
Also, by the way, Rufio is a firebender from The Last Airbender. So maybe that's the tie-in to that universe.
Oh, there you go. And then, of course, this is all set up. We watched this happen for like 11 goddamn minutes. This goes on forever.
They were just really proud of having set up this scene,
I guess.
The fire, however, whatever fucking thing they did. They're so proud of it. They're like, do we need just one? No. One fart. No. We need 40 of them. Just fucking four, just forever.
Oh, there's got to be at least 20 goddamn farts here. Yeah. And of course, the punchline to this scene is as they're sitting around asses in the air doing the fire farts, Jesse comes in and catches them. And that's very embarrassing. And I'm like, how the hell does she have a... Why would they give her a key to their hotel room if they were going to be lighting farts?
Yeah. Plus, they don't do anything with that. Like, she comes in and she's like, hey, what does she say? I don't know. She asked them.
I checked you out of the hotel room.
Oh, yeah. And then she just leaves.
Yep.
And they're
maybe they thought that was going to be positive. Like, she walks in and is like, you guys, right? Oh, did you lean in to the farting? No, I'm sorry. No, never mind. We're going to pack it up. It's cool.
Oh, you guys have ass flints too? Yeah, right. So, and now it's time for an extreme grocery shopping montage.
Extreme!
What the fuck? And, okay, so first of all, here's the great thing about this. They had permission to knock over one display. Right, so then like they're trying to do this like, oh, we've, you know, don't give a fuck about nothing, we're extreme, everybody get in a shopping cart, we're gonna push around and be crazy, but they're being so goddamn careful not to mess anything up.
Yeah.
They're taking stuff from the back of the shelves, keeping it all organized. Yeah. And then they finally knock over one thing. Yeah.
And this, you talked earlier about like someone having a soundtrack. She can hear the rock music that's them being extreme, but it's like quieter where she is. So like they're doing extreme race car cart, you know, shopping cart. By the way, this is like a gas station's worth of shopping. You know, this isn't a big like Safeway, like giant, you know, this is just a tiny thing. So there's no extreme. You're not going very fast. It's nothing. Like I would do this with my kid. If I put my kid in the cart and did this, the kid would be like, meh. It's not really that cool. But they play the music, you know, trying to make it cool. But like they go over to her and the music is a little quieter. And she's like, do I hear an extreme montage? Like, doesn't make
sense. Can't these guys shop without a montage?
It does. Is the music in, is it real or not? Like, is the music,
is the PA system playing softer in my aisle because I'm not in the montage technically?
Yeah, it's a very so dedicated, weird. The PA gets louder where people are being more extreme. It's very high tech. I don't know why. The guy thought they would sell more tomatoes in the grocery store if they did that or something. I don't know.
So, and then, of course, this all culminates in the race to the last half gallon of milk. Because you know when you're on a road trip, how you need to get a half gallon of milk?
Right. And they very specifically started with one shopping list.
Yep.
And then they tore it in half.
Yep.
And said, you get this, you get this. And then the other two guys tore that one in half, said, you get this, you get this. But then, even though they took pains to show us that fucking delegation process, they all say, we need milk. Like, what?
That they wrote three times on their list.
Apparently, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So they're all racing towards the milk, but damn it, if the old lady that's been, like, they've been harassing through the entire store doesn't beat them to the milk.
Yeah, they already knocked over an old lady.
Yeah, they did, because they're the good guys. And then the old lady gets in there and gets it, and they crash into the one display they were allowed to knock over, and Jesse walks up, the love interest walks up to Brian. She's like, see, this is why I don't want anything to do with you. You're a kind of asshole who can't even go to a grocery store without accosting an old lady.
And by the way, you were lighting your farts earlier. Like, I didn't want to bring it up, but like, that's fucking gross.
I'm not. Also, I hit you in the face with a spoon like 600 times in a row. You're so dumb. You're the dumbest.
You're really stupid, man. Sorry, I can't do it.
Will you put your head down for a second? I'm going to hit you in the face with a spoon again.
The other guy takes a hammer. Just like,
oh, you put a nail in that one. Well done. And then just to remind us that, like, she's right to ignore this asshole, he says, I wasn't on the list, but I bought you tampons because I was concerned for your vagina. Where are you going?
Yeah, and then we get the very hilarious, oh, no, you actually need these. Because
girl, you're a girl.
Menstruates? Yeah, because
you menstruate face.
Have his period. Yeah. What's the joke there?
And then, okay, so they all go to leave, and there's this little homeless family sitting right in front of the grocery store. Now, this scene is goddamn amazing, because what's supposed to happen is Brian, the love interest, is supposed to see this homeless family and go like, oh, guys, I have a whole bag full of food and you have none. Let me give you food. But he keeps giving them the wrong shit. It's just, he's like, he gives them pudding cups like, wow, you guys would need spoons for those, wouldn't you? Here's orange juice. You would need glasses. Why do I keep giving you things that require refrigeration?
Here's a raw slab of meat. Oh, got some ground beef.
Here's a George Foreman grill and a gas generator that I also bought.
Yeah.
Oh, here's I'll get you a gallon of gas in a second. I'm going to come back. But
here's what I love about this scene. Because the whole point of it, obviously, is, oh, well, he actually has a heart of gold. You see this lovable guy. And the girl, you know, is supposed to notice. He's not trying to do it for her to know, but she notices. And I was thinking about it. I was like, so wait, doesn't this mean that the girl is actually a total piece of shit? Like, she just walked right by the family. Doesn't care. Doesn't, turns around, is like, where's the love interest? Oh, he's over there feeding. Oh, that's kind of nice of him. Anyway, let's go.
Right,
like,
right, because they all, the rest of them have food in their hands when this happens. Yeah. Right, and they're like, yeah, oh, that's a good thing he took care of that.
And we've established that she's the Christian. Like, earlier on, it was like, oh, she's the best. She prays every day, she blah, blah, blah. Meanwhile, she walks right by this family. Doesn't give a shit.
Yep.
I want him to take out a Bible at the end of this and then just be like, no, thank you. No, you can have your pudding and orange juice. I'm good. Yeah. I'm good.
No, but I love it because this, it's exactly Christian charity, which is you're going to do enough charity for a girl to be like, oh, that's nice. But then no more. Like, that's the maximum.
Yeah, exactly.
Amount.
But you're not really going to help this family at all because.
Yeah, the girl's not going to help the kids because the girl has nothing to prove.
Right.
Yeah, but it's just for the guy who has something to prove is going to help those homeless people.
And then, God damn it, they said earlier in this movie that this was taking place in August. They could have said a different month. It's their movie. It could be any month. But no, this is August. And luckily for them, just then, there was an August snowstorm.
Mm-hmm.
So they went snowboarding.
Well, they stopped by Mount Everest in Oregon or wherever they're supposed to be now.
So fucking stupid. So yeah, now we just end up with this long ass snowboarding montage.
It's like 40 feet of perfect powder. Yes! Too. And he's like montages.
One of them awesome fucking August 40 feet of snowstorms. Yes.
And then I love too, because they're like, oh, this girl could ride. We couldn't find any footage of it or anything, but we're sure. Like,
but trust us, there was a female who could snowboard. Yeah,
the unsaid part of the narration was like, well, here, take a look at these stuntmen and see and imagine what she would look like in their place doing the same thing, because she could ride.
Well, and then, of course, like this all wraps up and one of them comes up to her and says, Brian comes up and says, man, you're really good. Where'd you learn to snowboard? And she goes, men, penises, I learned from men.
Men who had a different camera, and now we have a new camera just now. It's fun. And My Chemical Romance is there a lot. Yeah. Also.
And then, and Brian walks up to her and says, huh, hey, would you like to do a super scary thing you don't want to do with me? And he looks over at Corey like, eh?
Is that apropos of nothing?
Yeah. No, it doesn't. She doesn't do it. Well, this is the part that
or she does do
yes.
it.
Yes.
This is my 2-minute flashback.
Yeah, right, because that's where the scene ends, but we're going to go back to that scene in a minute, because wouldn't you know it, just that fucking night, there happened to be a live performance by Rage in Favor of the Machine.
Yeah, Matt had another cousin. This is like his 8th cousin that we
meet. This fucking Cousin Ex Machina shit is wearing thin, guys. Yeah.
But it's such a great bit, though. I laugh every time.
God damn it.
Cousins.
I hate these people so much, and they ramp it up so hard here, because Matt's cousin is in a rap rock band.
Yeah.
I hate the entire family. Like, after the concert, we go hang out with Matt's other cousins, Guy Fieri and Ed fucking Hardy. Like, it's everything I hate. They look into this.
Pretty much. I love, too, that, like, is it that hard to sync the sound up to the band so it looks like they're really
Jesus
playing?
Jesus Christ.
God, it's not yes, that hard.
It sure is, man. It is too fucking hard. Well,
you know what? Maybe in 2001 with 90s video technology that they probably were running with. Maybe that was a little hard.
Well, yeah, they were 5 years behind on that, too.
Yeah, I love, too, because this is, as you say, Rage in Favor of the Machine. It's a concert / talent show for anybody who wants to come up on stage and do anything.
I know
bands love that. Like, if a band is playing a gig, they love, hey, does anybody else want to come up and, like,
cut. I just wanted to do some, it's my turn. I go now. Slam poetry.
Yes. Wow. Hell. Extreme poetry, Heath.
Yeah. God damn. I didn't think they could ramp it up from cousin Guy Fieri and Ed Hardy. And then this asshole stops a band in the middle of a show and does slam poetry. Like, all right, he might as well tell me a story about people I don't know from his job, like, for 25 minutes on the stage. I got so angry.
Well, he's painting some modern art or something.
Yeah, the crowd doesn't know who he is. Like, I love it, though, because it really is. I truly believe this. It's a window into the entitlement of, like, Christian men in this country. Like, if black people were making a movie, it would not have the world revolves around these characters. Like, these characters go to a place and everybody's like, well, stop the band we all came to see. Naturally, we want to hear this guy's slam poetry about something we don't even fucking know about. God.
All right, let's go watch him park badly now out front. That's going to be great. Heath will love this. What the fuck? I hated it so much.
And then keep in mind that, like, as we're watching this, so they're at this party and they he does this little extreme poem and he brings Jesse up and she tells us how that last scene ended. She never gives us an indication why they didn't just show it to us. But throughout all of this, like, the extras who are at this party are very clearly sick and fucking tired of this and want to listen to the band. Right? Like everybody's chanting, Jesse, when she comes up on stage. It's only the characters from the movie. The rest of the audience is like, just get off the fucking stage.
I know. They're like, should we call the police? Like, this is weird. I've never like had to deal with people who don't respond to public pressure. Like, you can't shame these. What do we do? I mean, they just stopped our concert. Like, well, do we fight them? I don't. This is insane. Like, what's wrong with these people?
Do you guys know you're awful? They don't know. Do you hear me? You see me. You're looking at me while I'm saying this. You're terrible.
You're still smiling and laughing like this is a fun old time. We all want you to die right now. Like, we want to listen to the rage in favor of the machine.
Is that a fucking tub of hummus? Did you bring loose hummus in?
All right, so then, okay, so that scene ends. We rock and roll our way back onto the road with yet another montage. This is an intra-montage montage here. Mm. So now they basically run out of extreme sports. Don't worry, they'll find another one. So we have to have like a montage of not quite X Games material where they're like jumping off of rocks into water and climbing rocks. By the way, jumping into water, not an excuse to see Jesse in a swimsuit in this fucking movie.
Oh, yeah.
Right.
That could have been like the one redeeming factor, but no.
No, not in this goddamn movie. And I just wrote in my notes as they're doing this montage, I'm like, this is a weird trip to a funeral.
The movie's just a map screen at this point, like a video game map screen, like Street Fighter 2, yep. Where you're just flying from thing to thing. They go to Vegas to fight Balrog now. No, you don't see it, but they do.
Yeah.
And then, okay, so then this montage comes to a close in an Oregonian forest where they have, fucking damn it, where they have to fight for a campsite with this little racist kung fu thing.
Yeah, are you allowed to just do Wayne's World for your movie? Can you do that? You're like, hey, I like that scene in Wayne's World where they do the dubbing and fight. I thought that was funny. I'll just do that for my movie.
I guess.
Can you?
Yeah.
God.
So I could just be like, tomorrow I could be like, hey, I like Anchorman. Let's just all do Anchorman in my movie. Like, I'll just do
I
that.
Guess. Well, so, okay, so here's what happened. Everyone involved in this movie really wanted to play ninja, but nobody wanted everybody to know that they wanted to play ninja, so they all pretended that it was ironic, and they played ninja.
Very likely what happened.
Because, look, they're all just going like, tee-hee, this is kind of fun, but, like, very clearly, they all worked on these goddamn moves, right? They're pretty proud of their sweet fucking ninja skills.
Well, I think they all looked at Rufio and were like, you can do kung fu, right? Like, I mean,
I know karate too.
We all assumed you could do kung fu.
Yeah, I'm the Asian guy. I got it. But like, do we all? Cool.
No, we hired you because I know it wasn't on your resume, but
the sad thing is that he can actually. He's really fucking good. He's like the one person here.
All Asian people are firebenders. You guys are assholes. Like, that's not the point. Yes, we are, but like, it's a weird thing to say.
Yeah, you shouldn't have just assumed. Yeah, okay, I'll do some cool.
No, I do. I can. Like, God, look, fire. But like, come on.
Yeah. So
now I almost don't want to, even though I totally can. But like, I
am many things.
So yeah. So this goes on forever, man. Like, so we watch this goddamn weird-ass, random-ass, comedic-esque fight scene for, I don't know, 6.5 years. We're all older. Eli's fucking kid can vote by the end of it.
Well, or could if it weren't for Republicans, I'm sure.
Yeah, by then. I mean, the kid's he's one quarter Jewish at this point, I think. You know, so.
There's one all the Jewish people district in New Jersey.
So. All right, but yeah, but they lost their ninja encounter over the last available campsite, so they camped somewhere else. I mean, right, because they did camp.
Yeah, like they try to make it like, oh, we had to camp next to the porta potties, but it's like,
that's convenient.
I don't know, like, I'm pretty sure campsites you could find someplace, anyway, whatever, who cares.
Yeah, also pretty sure people just shit in the woods in the campsites. Yeah. You don't need. Yeah,
yeah.
And then they start talking about, like, this, they're going to get serious for a minute. They start talking about ghost stories, and that reminds Corey of how Grandpa G sure told the best ghost stories, huh?
I'm just expecting the very smooth transition. You know who the raddest ghost ever was, though? Was that guy named Jesus.
The Holy Ghost.
No, but they're just like, you know who told the best ghost stories? Somebody who's not here. I couldn't
you can
even
imagine
tell
how great that would
about the story.
Be,
but, yeah. You guys want to watch a YouTube video about other people telling ghost stories?
We can do a montage. That'd be great. And then fucking Corey starts talking about how bummed he is that his stepdad's a prick, and I'm like, dude, it is too goddamn late in the movie for this character, this minor character, to end up with a shitty stepdad. Fuck you. You had your chance at a shitty stepdad.
And then at one point, I don't know if it's Rufio, one of them's like, I don't know, how am I supposed to feel? And I'm thinking like, yeah, no, really, tell me. Like, the script doesn't say, like, how am I supposed to do it? I think I'm upset. Yeah. And then this is where I think Rufio's like, you know, if anyone could offer me anything to you know, about the fact that I'm missing Grandpa G, anybody have anything at all?
Shut up, Firebender.
And then Jesse chimes in and she says, you know, when I was a kid, my dad left. And I'm like, God damn it. No, you don't get a backstory, too. But that's when and she says, but you know what? That's when I became a Christian and everything was just fine. And I'm like, you're damn right. It was.
There it is.
56 yeah. minutes in. That's got to be a fucking record.
What did she had like a piece of paper that said God understands on it or something like there was like a post-it note.
Yeah. That solved all her problems.
Yeah. And Rufio's like, cool, God understands. Well, that guy killed my grandpa is what I was talking about. Like 3 days ago, that guy killed my grandfather. So fuck your face.
Yeah, it's like a hitman leaving his mark or whatever. God takes out your grandpa and then is like, God understands what just happened. I'm like, fuck you, man.
He comprehends the murder he did. I don't see how that's helpful to me as a slogan.
But Christians are really like that, where they're like, oh, yeah, you know, I almost died or my mom died, whatever. And then Jesus said they understand or something. You know, it'll be something like that. And you're like, what? That works for you? How does that?
Yeah, right. God, even if that was true, it wouldn't help, though, would it?
Yeah. Like, I wish I had that where they're like, oh, yeah, I just left it all in God's hands.
You know, it turns out that Mimsy were the Borogovs. Oh, OK. Shit. Well, yeah.
What?
All right. Well, yeah, there you go. Jingly. Keys. All right. Well, I'll tell you what. Things are getting pretty heated among the crew. Fucking Corey was really hostile to that effort to make him feel better with Jesus. So everybody needs a minute to calm down. That means we're going to take a quick break. But first, let me give Act 3 the hard sell. Can the narrator exhibit a personality trait before it's too late? Will the gang be able to find a plot in time? Can we just watch some skateboarding again? Find out the answers to these questions and more when we return for the extreme conclusion of Extreme Days. Hey, Heath, where's Eli?
Yeah, how should I put this? So, are you familiar with the term dolce far niente?
Oh, is that a legal term?
No, it's Italian for the pleasure of doing nothing. Like the way it feels when you take off for paternity leave, but you still don't have a kid, so it's actually not paternity leave.
Man, that sure is frustrating for the rest of us.
Yeah, you're just on vacation. You know, I have a great secret for calming down when I'm frustrated in times like this.
Some kind of deep breathing thing?
Beer, actually.
Okay, I feel better about this advice now.
Yeah, and not just any beer, Noah. Italian beer. Peroni, in particular. Peroni was born in Italy in 1963 with the goal of creating a beer that would embody Italian values like quality, craftsmanship, and style. And I love it, alongside small bites like olives, nuts, bruschetta, or even a plate of fine meats and cheeses.
Wow, that sounds great.
Yeah, it is. Peroni blends the finest hops with two-row spring-planted barley and carefully imports it to the U.S.
Carefully?
Yep, it's in the copy. They said carefully. No idea. But I do know it has a refreshing taste, and it's the ideal beer when you want to relax. Look for Peroni at your next happy hour, or find it in cans and bottles at your local grocery store and follow them on Instagram at Peroni USA. Peroni Italia. Whatever you do, do it beautifully.
For people over the age of 21 only, 2020 imported by Birra Peroni International, Washington, D.C.
You know, Corey, when my father left me, I was burdened by the same sense of crushing loss that you feel about your grandpa now. And there was one very important piece of advice that helped me through. Would you like me to share it with you?
Wow. Yeah, Jesse, that would be very helpful. Please do.
Okay, here it is. It's what got me through the darkest times of my childhood. Jesus, 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 Jesus.
Oh, you're done?
Yeah, did that help? Did that fix it?
Gonna be honest, not really.
No?
No. No, you just said Jesus four times, and then I thought you had a follow-up, but that was it. That was the end of your thing.
Right. No, that's it.
Yeah, that's not advice. That's just the key figure in your religion. You just said it.
Right.
I mean, that's fine and all. Like, I'm glad religion helped you through your trauma, but that doesn't make Jesus, 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 Jesus advice. That's again, you're just saying it.
Let me rephrase it for you.
Okay.
When I was saddened by the loss of my father, I just remembered that my religion was better than all other religions and way better than no religion at all.
Okay. Quick thing. Would you call that advice or more bigotry?
Is there a difference?
Sure is. Yeah.
Yeah. Agree to disagree.
No.
And we're back for still more of this shit. It's the next day. They're back on the road. And damn it, if they didn't happen upon a BMX montage along the way that day. So weird. It'd be another montage.
I had just been thinking this movie doesn't have enough stunt montages of people who aren't the actual characters under completely generic B-side bullshit 90s punk rock. I was just thinking that, wouldn't you know it?
Well, what's amazing to me about this one is that they've like given up the pretense at all that these are the characters in the movie, right? Or that this is some weird thing that like is coincidental. Everything else, like, yeah, they were going by a mountain, so they snowboarded. They were by an ocean, so they surfed. But now it's just like, yeah, no, there was just like an X Games qualifying event going on apparently here.
Yeah.
So, yeah, we went to a really wide margin convention in Eugene, Oregon. That was a good 19 minutes.
They also threw in some footage of people totally eating shit into this one.
Oh, yeah.
But it's also, like, grainier. So, like, they found a different VHS tape for that.
That was really... Yeah, because we've already moved away from the type of cameras they'd been using up to this point to this event. And then, yeah, we go to like somebody's fucking 1998 flip phone camera or something for this wipeout footage.
I had to like turn off Vimeo and like fire up a Betamax to watch this part. It was a whole thing.
A nerdy kid pushed a projector in. It was crazy.
Yeah, you have to have like a de-scrambler or whatever. I just imagine that someone on the crew was like, well, I have these like snuff films that are, I mean, they have their like VHS collection of people like dying on the fucking skateboard and stuff that they put in.
Jesus.
All of a sudden the Zapruder film is on. Hold on. Wait a second. Back into the left. That doesn't make sense. What?
All right. So yeah. So late that night after the BMX montage, they're driving along and Jesse gets a phone call. Brian in the front seat. He's flirting some more. She's only told him no 37 times now. 38 times the charm.
They're driving like you do. I too often drive with a giant floodlight at my feet, which lights everyone in the car as they're trying to sleep.
Yeah,
that's how
I
drive.
So bad. And they clearly tried to improvise this moment. Like the guy who played Brian was like, I actually do a British accent. It's pretty great. Yeah, I'll vamp this whole thing and it'll be awesome. But after like 8 seconds of him trying to do that, both actors clearly panicked because they ran out of talking.
They tap out.
They literally tap out. The movie had to cut the audio and put music over it after 8 seconds of trying to vamp his talking.
Yes, because in second nine, both of them were just going, hats.
Yes.
The characters are like, we're bonding.
We are.
They like ran. They just literally start saying what they're doing.
Yeah, right. No, exactly. If you can read lips, it's just bonding the entire time.
I love too that this fucking Barbie car that they've been driving this whole time does not have a top to it.
No.
So in reality, every single scene of them driving and talking would be.
What?
That would be every single
gravel in my eye. Gravel in my eye. It's
what?
Right there.
Oh, there's a bug in my fucking. Ow!
What?
Oh, we just hit a bug. Ow! We're going 80.
I said a bug.
What?
What?
I need a hospital. There's bug. Oh!
British accent. What?
We're bonding. I said we're bonding. You and I are bonding.
James Bond?
No, we're flirting.
He's British. Yes, and British.
I love you, maybe? Are we to that? We're bonding.
I love spending time with you.
Yeah, no.
Jesus fucking Christ. So we get that scene. And then, okay, so then I guess they all slept in the fucking car. We get the next morning, there's this, they have the early morning paintball attack montage.
Oh, yeah.
Yep. This was just another one of those things where somebody was like, I know karate. They were like, you know what? I have pretty sweet paintball skills. Me too. Holy yep. shit. Okay. Okay. We're going to do that.
But I like, at first I thought, because they're all sleeping and then he goes, you know, the main schmuck goes, Jesse, come here. And I was like, oh, they're going to go fuck, you know? And then like, they wake up Billy Joe Armstrong, who you forget is in this movie at this point.
I had to look up the character's name at this point because I had to write it in the notes.
But I love it because it's like, who invited? Why did you wake him? I wanted to go fight. Oh, what are you going to do?
Freeway?
No.
Okay. All right. Yeah.
No,
all right.
No, we're just going to do a paintball prank. You're like, oh, we had different things in mind.
Okay. Yeah. And so they start firing fucking paintballs at each other. And we have this enormously long goddamn scene. And again, it's we have to watch Brian and Jesse bond, right? But now they're bonding over their mutual paintball fun.
Which, and you know, the other two idiots hide in the car and then they just shoot the car a bunch. Like, wouldn't you just wait to,
I don't know. Yeah. And
this whole thing, it's so sad because this is clearly like the dream scenario of meeting a woman for whatever piece of shit person wrote this. Like, I harass her into a road trip with my friends and she hangs out. No, I do my amazing British improv. Yeah,
she beats me with a spoon.
I finally charm her with my heroic paintball dive roll things. He's such a piece of shit. I hate it so much.
Oh, I do.
Yeah. No, this is a fucking incel love story. Absolutely.
And then during this battle, the fucking stoner jumps up and goes, Wolverine! Like, right. Is that a shooty thing to say?
I don't think that means what he thinks it means.
Wolverine.
I want to see the X-Men play paintball now, but that's unrelated.
Pretty fucking cool.
It doesn't really work.
And also, I feel like probably the saddest moment in this entire movie is to me is when Brian, the ladies' man character, turns to Jesse and he says, "Here, take these," and he hands her a box of candy, and it's Mike and Ike's, which is the most disgusting goddamn candy that could even theoretically exist. No.
It's insult to injury, certainly.
Yeah, it's pretty fucking disgusting.
Yeah, we all agree Mike and Ike's are stupid. They're not good. It's the movie theater giant box of Mike and Ike's.
Why does he have that?
Which means this guy went to the movies and was like,
spent $23.
You know what? I'm going to spend $23 on an extra, like, carry Mike and Ike's to go with
me. Right. Mm-hmm. But hey, that'll come back later. It'll be important.
No.
So now they arrive in Portland and we get the scene. So this is long in the making here, but we get the scene where Brian and Jesse are at the pool at the hotel, fully fucking dressed, no bathing suits or anything. And they're flirting some more. Right.
Yeah.
And she turns to him and she says, "You must have had a lot of girlfriends." And he goes, "No, not really. I mean, a non-gay amount of girlfriends. Heterosexual, normal, low, but heterosexual."
Yeah, he has to find that real Christian sweet spot of like, I need to communicate that I'm into girls, but I also can't say like, I date plenty of girls.
Yeah, right,
Really tries to thread that needle. Never found the medium right one.
Yeah. What's the medium amount, you say?
I've certainly courted a few with female people. And then at a certain point, it's not going well, so he switches to negging. And he does the whole negging thing.
Oh, does he?
And then, and then she like rejects him and then he just fucking throws a tantrum.
Oh, yeah, right. So they kiss for a second. And then she's like, you know what? I really shouldn't get into a relationship right now. And then he screams and shouts and he goes, you know what your problem is? I'm toxically masculine. And he throws shit. Yeah.
Yeah. I was like, way to go on the character. You tried to set him up with the charity and the, you know, or whatever, like the giving up the food. But then she's like, maybe I don't want to do this now.
You think you're better than me? Fuck you. Chair throw. And she's like, I don't know what's happening in this movie or reality.
I can totally non-sexually kiss any girl in this hotel right now. Right now. And, then you wake up the next morning, the camera, you know, goes to the next morning and all the fucking poolside furniture is in the pool. Like he's that big of a fucking baby. This is your main character. God, and it's unbelievable.
That could have been the only good scene in the movie, watching him scream crying and throwing all the chairs into the pool. But they don't show us that.
Assholes. Well, what's funny is going into this scene, I'm looking at this actor and I'm thinking, because he looks to me like a young Greg Kinnear, right? And I'm like, this is a good looking kid. There's something likable about him. Yeah, why did he never go anywhere in the acting world? And by the end of this scene, we sure have our fucking answer, don't we? This was so hard to watch.
Yeah, I got one for you. Young Greg Kinnear combined with Joe Buck.
Okay. Yep. Yep. Absolutely.
He's got the Joe Buck hairline that, you know, every 19-year-old kid definitely. Yeah, sure, 19.
Got the Ron Swanson going.
So, yeah, so now it's the next morning, and it's time for Brian to apologize for all the furniture throwing last night, right? And he's going to apologize to Jesse, but if he showed up and apologized to his acting coach, I would have been so much happier. So, but she's left a note. She dipped the fuck out because he turned out to be violently insane.
Yeah.
Valid. Valid.
Yeah, that note should have said, seek help. You genuinely scared me last night. Like, I tried to say no, and you threw an entire patio's worth of furniture into a pool. At a hotel. Like, this, what part of this is okay to you? How could you possibly think there's any chance that I'm going to be, like, that's what the note should have said.
I can't believe I even have to write any of this note. And it's not just you. It's literally all of you, your whole group of friends. You're terrible, terrible people.
Like, the actual actress was writing that. Like, this is not okay. Like, what are we doing here? They just ignored it.
You guys just drive around going to montages. It's so fucking boring, too. It's not just that you're toxic. It's that you're boring.
Well, and then, but so, of course, because it was some goddamn dude that wrote this fucking movie, her note is all filled with apologies for being such a damn lady about everything and having such a lady brain, right? It's like, I owe you so much more than this. You did harass me for, you know, consistently for days on end, so I do owe you sex, but, right?
I'm waiting for marriage, so.
Yeah, exactly. But it ends with, she's like, but I'm waiting for marriage. Christian movie. And then, speaking of Christian fucking movie, they can't have him drinking alcohol, right? They can't have him just sitting at the bar having a beer in the middle of the day. So the substitute for the rest of the film is going to be binge eating powdered donuts messily.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
The beer is way more healthy for you.
Right.
I'm just saying. Like, they really should binge drinking better than that. At least that's what I tell myself.
So Will comes in and he's like, hey, Brian, you know, what's the matter, man? You going to get over this shit? We still have, like, we got 18 minutes to wrap up this fucking movie. And he's like, you know what? Dead leukemia sister, man. Dead leukemia sister.
Yeah. You remember when God killed my sister? I want to fuck Jesse. And his buddy Will is like, dude, hey, if you don't mind, can you just separate those two things? Like, even just by a couple of seconds in your speech would be fucking great.
Yeah. Well, and he has to give the obligatory, like, oh, I need to, this guy's got a lot going on. Here, I know, I'll try. Hey, you all right? you good, bro?
You okay?
You, ready to go? God, so, you mean go get so some dirt? Emotionally you're rubbing into fucking it?
Also,
stunted.
Doesn't Will say to him here, he's like, hey, you don't think God was sad about that? You know, killing the sister with leukemia? Like, just God weeping as he injects this little girl with blood cancer, being like, oh,
I have,
man,
no choice. My hands are tied.
This hurts me more than it hurts you.
Yep.
Yeah.
So,
I, God, had to invent a thing called childhood blood cancer and give it to this child.
I feel what, I mean, it's awful
just, that's
about
just
it.
Logic.
It's not all about you. I had to do that.
Oh, for fuck's sake. And then there's this weird moment where the movie tries to do meta, right? And look, like, you can do meta. I'm fine with that. We do it all the fucking time. But you can't just suddenly do meta now.
Oh, wait. When Matt had a stroke?
Yeah. So Matt comes in. He's like, hey, man, I we need to get going. And Will's like, dude, just chill out. Why don't you just take over my voiceover for a minute? Because Will's been the one narrating the entire time. And then Matt doesn't know what to do with the voiceover.
I don't even. Yeah, I just chose to pretend none of that happened. Honestly,
that's probably a good idea. You know what? That's fucking company policy. None of that happened. And so then we get this great moment. They got to get back on the road. This is so fucking stupid. Oh, this is the actual line. He goes, you know, a famous person once said, life's a trip.
I can't name that famous person, but they're fucking famous. I'm quite certain.
I'm pretty sure famous and non-famous people have probably said that. So sure.
Yeah.
And then immediately after that, it was like, this trip had become about our lives. Life's a trip. Trips about our life. Reality is a metaphor for reality.
Is this where we're to believe that they are driving a car with no top in pouring rain?
Yep.
Like they're just dry. That's just. And then they like take down the windshield. They're like, oh, can't see through the windshield. Let's like knock it down. None of that works. You can't do that. It does, there's no way.
Well, yeah. So because
can't do that.
Yeah. This is supposed to represent that like, oh, the trip was getting rough at this point. It's like, yeah, I bet it rained before that. You guys are going to Seattle. But now they finally made it, right?
Yeah. Hey, guys, let's all hop in our car that has no top and go to Seattle.
Yeah.
There won't be any weather concerns there. I'm sure it'll be bright, sunny driving.
Might hit an August snowstorm here and there. But other than that. Jesus fucking Christ. But they finally made it. Jesus goddamn Christ. They finally fucking made it. They gather together around Grandpa G's grave.
Yeah.
Right? And I'm writing in my notes like, I bet at least 4 or 5 minutes of the runtime left is credits at least, right? Credits? So.
And I love that like Grandma G. Yeah. Grandma G is there and she's like super okay with the grandfather having died. I love it. She's like, oh yeah, no, this is time.
Yeah,
I don't even miss him really. I'm glad he's dead. I'm finally living life. It's really his life was a burden to me and I'm free now. Yeah, she's so okay with it.
Pre-over it, wasn't she? Like honestly, if you concluded that Grandma G killed Grandpa G, this scene makes a ton more sense. Yeah.
Absolute certain. She's
like, you ever try to sleep next to somebody? It's just exhausting. Why would anybody want to do that? Like now I spread out. I use the whole fucking bed. I roll over when I want to. I don't smell the other person. It's the best.
Yeah. Well, when they rush, it's like, oh, what are you guys doing here? Why are you so sad? Oh, yeah, yeah, okay, yeah.
Dead
grandpa. Grandpa died. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Right. No, I remember.
My husband
I remember that.
Died.
My husband died.
50 years. Yeah.
Sometimes, yeah, I just forget.
Steve, yes, Steve. Right, yep.
That was his name. Yeah, no, okay.
But this is where we learn that, damn it, Grandpa G wasn't as rich as Corey thought. He wasted the family fortune before he died investing in snake meat. Because he's the only goddamn ethnic person in the fucking... Guys, come on. God, don't do that.
It's just so stupid on every level. I can't handle it. Again, can I do pretend this didn't happen, but with the whole movie?
Oh, that's interesting. We need to work on the flashy thing technology from Men in Black. That would be very helpful for us. Yeah.
Yes, we're to believe that a wealthy, well-off guy invested his whole money, everything... into snake meat. And then they do a little joke at the end of the commercial they're watching for no reason.
Mm-hmm.
That's like FDA approval pending or something like, oh yeah, definitely he would blow all his money on a thing like that. Fucking God, I hate it. I hate this movie.
Yeah,
I hate it.
Right. No, their efforts at humor are so painful.
Eli had to have a fucking kid.
Right. Motherfucker. He did it just to piss you off. Just to fuck
what
with
kind
you.
Of
you
asshole
know
would
he
have
did.
Kids.
So
God.
All right, so now, and the other fucked up thing is that they sit around. Now, luckily, Grandma G is completely over this, because if not, she would probably take offense at the fact that Corey then sits around in her living room loudly complaining that he's not profiting as much off his grandpa's demise as he was hoping to.
Poor people dying is stupid. It doesn't even mean nothing happens.
He might as well have not even died.
God. And the whole, like, twist here is that they were supposed to get a bunch of money from the inheritance when they showed up and it's all gone.
Yeah.
Because of something.
The snake
and
meat.
Oh, it was the snake meat was a failed investment.
Yeah.
Is that the actual plot point?
Yeah. They're saying he invested his, not only that, he put up his house for the snake meat thing. Cause like they don't even have the house anymore.
Yeah.
She says the bank owns the house, but she's still living there.
They have no idea how anything works.
I was going to say, like, that means you bought a house. That's how it works. Like, they don't. I'm going to buy a house. Here's what I do. I take out a mortgage, and once I've paid it all off in 30 years, I can move into the house. That's not how it fucking works, you idiots. Oh, the bank owns the house. Yeah. You either are evicted or you're paying a mortgage to pay. Anyway.
Yeah.
Yeah. The point is they don't have any money. Like, the plan was, all right, now we're going to have a whole bunch of money to do our trip to more. Yeah.
Back to Mexico. There's still some hot sauce needs drinking.
Right. Right. Yeah, exactly. It's still Corey's turn. God damn it.
Yeah, he never went. This is all a long con to just get out of the hot sauce.
He's like, Grandma, can you kill Grandpa? I don't want to chug this done chili and done. Sauce.
I was planning on doing that anyway. Can I? Let me just pull out my pre-scripted plans for murdering my husband. Hold on. Let's see.
But then August. Will has an idea. Him and Matt are looking through the newspaper trying to figure out what they're going to do, right? Because they don't have enough money to get home.
Yeah.
And this is where he sees that there's some people who are selling some cheap tickets to Alaska, which isn't where they live, but that's still pretty good.
Yeah, the idea is that if they can fly to Alaska, then what?
They'll be in Alaska.
And for gold?
Yeah.
What the fuck's happening here? Yeah. I have no idea. They were like, all right, well, we've got 15 minutes left in our arc lives. gold rush?
I plan? Guess, yes.
It's, right? Yeah. It's 2001. There's a gold rush.
Alaska is definitely a place you want to fly to when you have no money and no place to live and no housing. Like,
yeah.
You just, oh, we'll figure it out. We'll just go in Alaska and just...
The governor's just paying you like $30,000 to go there. Yeah.
That's probably actually
true.
She
read all the books.
Yeah, well, no. You'll probably just find a bus you can live in somewhere along the way. You'll be fine. You can eat berries. So, yeah, they decide they're going to go to Alaska, but they need to raise some money. So Grandpa G left Corey this junker of a car. So they have to sell the car. And, of course, they're going to do that with a fucking montage.
Yeah, the best way to sell a car is to try to stop people who are driving by in their cars, their fully functional cars.
This montage makes so little fucking sense. So their plan was to walk outside in the yard and sell that car that afternoon?
Via the lemonade stand model.
Yeah, exactly. Yep, violent lemonade stand model, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
But just as they're about to give up on their goal of selling a car that doesn't run for cash that afternoon from the yard, Will comes out to explain that he just sold the car on the internet.
Whoa, the internet? Yeah, he says junkyards.com. So I actually went there just for fun to check if it was. And the website actually is still in 2001. Like, if you go to junkyard, I'm not, this looks like I built this website in 10th grade on Angel Fire.
Amazing.
So, like, I appreciate their dedication to, I don't know if they made the site or they just kept it in 2001 forever.
All right. So they sold the car. They made $1,500. Now they can go to Alaska, which is, I guess, the plot.
Yeah. Step three, profit.
I love too that, like, they're all happy that they sold the car, and Grandma G, who lost a husband days ago, is like, hooray, you sold the inheritance for like a one-time trip to Alaska.
Way, she's destitute. She's destitute. Yeah. We've already decided that she has no money and the house isn't hers. And for all we know, she's about to be evicted, I guess, if that's what they're going for. But they're like, hey, we sold your car and we're blowing the money on nothing.
So technically your house, we sold your house, the only house you have. And it's our money also now.
Yeah, right.
Like, take all her food. just raid the entire fridge of the cabinet. Bye, Grandma.
Take care. All right, so they're heading to the airport to go to Alaska.
Stripping out her fillings from her teeth.
Jesus Christ.
She wakes up in an ice bath. Okay, that's pretty funny. I get it. This will pay for a sweet Alaska trip.
All right, so they're heading to the airport. They're going to go to Alaska, but they need to make one stop along the way. They have to slow motion walk into that college where Jesse went and bother her in the middle of her job.
It's madness. He walks into her meeting. She's like, doing freshman orientation for 100 freshmen in this room. And he's like, hey, I came to get you. And she's like, what?
To take you to Alaska.
He's like, come to Alaska now. She's like,
why would I go to Alaska?
No, I'm a student at this college. You're dumb. No.
What's in Alaska?
Yeah, me.
Doesn't matter. You know what? Doesn't matter. I don't know why I even started dwelling on Alaska. No, it's just a no.
Yeah. And he says, but I like the way you don't want to have sex with me until we're married. And she's like, just leave. And Matt says, hey, okay, we're going to leave, but I'm going to hand you this ticket anyway, because otherwise it doesn't. How would you get through airport security later? Sense.
But I love the main Joe Buck's pitch for like why they should be together is like, oh, you beat me with spoons. You knocked me on my butt. I'm like, do you need an abusive part? Like, is that what you need in a relationship? You hit me with a 2x4. You stapled my balls to the floor that one time. I can't quit you. I mean, you just... You punched me in the face. Like, what the fuck? That's your idea of a...
Yeah.
You watch me shit myself trying to fart a flamethrower thing. And you still went on a road trip.
You tried to kill me for
longer.
The insurance money. You tried, like, what?
So, well, yeah, so she says no. So we cut to the airport. Brian sadly waits at the airport with a single carnation, hoping that she'll show up, but she doesn't.
Yeah, where do you find one flower that shitty? Like, where did he buy that? He has the shittiest crap.
Oh, he didn't buy that flower, sir.
Flower. No, yeah.
I was growing in the smoking section outside.
He just ran around a gas station with a shopping cart grabbing one flower.
Yeah. I'm telling you, that's worse than not a flower. There are some gifts where it's like, it would be better to not give a gift than to give this.
Right. You know? Like, $38 is worse than just nothing. Yeah, exactly. So, yeah, but she doesn't show up. So he sets down his sad ass little flower and he gets on the plane, all super sad. And Jesus, this makes no fucking sense. Earlier in the movie, he had given her some Mike and Ikes during the goddamn paintball gun fight thing. So now the flight attendant comes and she's like, hey, sir, I think you dropped these Mike and Ikes.
God.
And the movie is just like, huh? It's a callback. And we're like, no, it really isn't. It's not technically a callback. It's just a thing.
So we're to believe that she had time to finish her freshman orientation, tell her boss, like, hey, I know I have a job at the school, but I'm just going to not do that. And also still give me room and board or whatever this arrangement is for this job. And now I'm going to beat them to the airport, find the plane, sit in a different part than what our ticket probably is, because it's four tickets together. That doesn't make sense.
Yep.
I'm going to sit in a different seat in the back. I'm going to tip a stewardess to then do a Mike and Ike thing.
I'm
going to
stop at a theater
sense.
And buy the big thing of Mike and Ike.
Right. She had to go to theater.
Yeah. It makes perfect sense.
Yep.
It's all fits.
All for the reveal. And then in the reveal, they basically, they violate all of the rules of being on an airplane one after the other. They seriously, they might as well start helping someone else with their mask before putting on their own. Right? Because like she calls him on the phone and you're like, that should really be in silent airplane mode right there. And they're talking on the phone. They get up out of their seats and it's like everybody's sitting around going, we can't taxi until you assholes sit down. They sit in the wrong fucking place. It's just, it's amazing. They're like, they sit in the fucking emergency exit row, even though they're not willing to help.
The world revolves around these people.
Yeah.
Everyone is just there to serve them. Like the whole plane's probably like, yay. Like we weren't actually having lives. We're just glad you guys have lives.
Yeah. No, we were all standing around hoping you would hit each other in the head with spoons or something because we're so starved for entertainment. Yeah.
There's an Asian doctor getting dragged off. He stops. He's like, I'm going to fucking drag them off. I will help. This is ridiculous. Look at them. Assholes. Mike and Ikes? Really?
Ah, Jesus Christ. And then, of course, she sings, right? Because she sings in public, and that's scary, and now he wins the bet with her.
I know this is a minor thing, but, like, both times they sing, if someone was like, hey, for bet purposes... You're going to have to sing something.
I think
what
I know
you
where you're
sing?
Going.
What would you sing? You know, like, you would pick any
London Bridge,
Farmer in the Dell.
Falling down, perhaps.
The Farmer in the Dell is what they sing both times.
Yes.
God.
That's my go-to karaoke. I go hard on Farmer in the Dell. It's either that or Don't Stop Believing, but I usually go Farmer in the Dell.
Every karaoke always has Farmer in the Dell. Like, it's like a little dinky, like, two notes, like, the backing track.
I do it. I usually do it as a duet, as a round. It's pretty kick-ass.
Yeah, in the same section with Three Blind Mice and Row, Row, Row Your Boat. You know, all those hit karaoke songs.
Yeah, no, it was they would have used as, you know, like anything that was public domain, really. At that point, yeah,
exactly. But even among public domain, you could have found something better than the Farmer in the Dell. I'm
sure. So fucking weird. Yeah. All right, so yeah, and then the narrator goes, you know, because now they're in Alaska together. They're going to snowboard a bit. We're going to get a little montage of that before it's all over.
You bet your ass we have time for one last montage of not us.
It's all been building to this, guys.
We're at an hour 27. We fucking got this. Two more minutes. Three? Two and a half? That round.
We can re-edit that scene so that she actually did do the snowboardy thing and then punch
him. Fuck you.
Okay, fine. You win.
So yeah. And then the narrator comes on. I shit you not. The narrator actually says in his summary of the film, he says, some random things happened to us. Like, yep, that just summed up the fucking plot. Well done, man.
Setting up the sequel, baby. Wow. What happened to them?
The sequel is the autoplay on YouTube.
Yeah, right. YouTube, yeah, exactly.
We fucking watched. And then the narrator ends with, when God throws a curveball, don't duck.
What?
So for so many reasons, this is hilarious. Like, what the attempt at the baseball knowledge here is just so rough.
Don't so duck.
But like don't duck. You might get killed by leukemia, but maybe not.
What?
Yeah. I don't know.
Pitch? Do you duck from?
Don't duck. So it's like God's throwing some high heat to try to like back you off the plate.
Just.
But the metaphor is that you're supposed to just take it right in the fucking face.
Right? Yeah. Exactly. Like, it's like you got a helmet on for a reason. Get that walk.
Which I imagine that. God can put some MPH on that. Like, I imagine God is throwing a pretty hard curveball, so he's just dead then, right?
No, that 12-6 drop on God's curveball really throws off the hitter's timing.
Don't duck.
What the fuck was that?
Shouldn't it be like, don't not swing? Swing. Hey, yeah. When God throws a curveball, don't take the pitch, maybe? Or what?
Shoulder in there. Don't. Don't open your hips too early. What the fuck?
Yes.
Don't duck. Like,
maybe the first half of the analogy is the problem.
I want to know how baseball works. How does baseball work according to these people?
I just love the idea of this cowardly ass guy who wrote the movie ducking away from every curveball.
In their mind, fastballs, you just get hit by them, but curveballs, you're allowed to duck.
When God throws a fastball, you just get hit in the dick. Yeah. Yeah. Don't duck, because then your face is in front. Well, I don't know. Yeah.
So good. Explain baseball to me. Yeah. I want that author. Explain the game of baseball.
When God throws a curveball, charge the fucking mound, man. That's my advice.
Yeah.
Here, I'll tell you what. Show us a baseball montage. Come on, guys. We have earned a baseball montage. All right.
Yeah.
So, in conclusion, is there anything at all about the early 2000s we miss collectively?
What was that other thing that happened in September that Thomas was talking about?
Yeah, I forgot. Yeah,
those were the days. I really miss not having seen this movie.
Oh, that was nice. Good one. Good one. Meta.
I
had
30, however many years old I am, of not having seen this movie until this very yesterday.
Yeah.
I watched it.
30, nice. However many?
Yeah, I don't know. I'm in my 30s.
I have to do the math now.
Do you know precisely what year in your 30s you are, if you're in your 30s?
Me and Thomas are the same age. Yep. That is locked in. Mm-hmm.
All right. Well, that's going to do it for our review of Extreme Days. That is not going to do it for the episode just yet, though, because we still need to not stop doing this. So, Heath, tell us, what's on deck?
The Avenging Angel, Noah. That's right, Heath. You sound perfectly normal, and this transition will be super smooth.
Yeah, that one's coming up, and with that to look forward to, we're going to bring episode 249 to a merciful close. Once again, a huge thanks to all the Patreon donors that help make the show go. If you'd like to count yourself among their ranks, you can make a per-episode donation at patreon.com/godawful, and thereby earn early access to an ad-free version of every episode. You can also help out a ton by leaving a 5-star review and by sharing the show on all your various social media platforms. And if you enjoyed this show, be sure to check out our sibling shows, The Scathing Atheist, Citation Needed, D&D-, and The Skeptic Crowd, available wherever podcasts live. If you have questions or comments or cinematic suggestions, you can email godawfulmovies@gmail.com. Legal services for this podcast are provided by the law offices of P. Andrew Torres. Tim Robertson takes care of our social media. Our theme song is written and performed by Ryan Slotnick of People Drafts on Mars. All other music was written and performed by our audio engineer, Morgan Clark, and was used with permission. Thanks again for giving us a chunk of your life this week. For Heath Enright and Eli Bosdick, I'm No Illusions, promising to work hard to earn another chunk next week. Until then, we'll leave you with a Breakfast Club close.
1 week later, the entire crew realized they're stuck in Alaska with no money.
Yeah.
The end.
The crew eventually learned what drugs were and never had to chug hot sauce again.
I've held my tongue for whatever 10, 12 episodes I've done, but Noah still doesn't just pre-record that ending message and use it at the end of every episode.
Morgan fucks with me if I try to do that.
Every time.
I know. Morgan fucks with
me. I don't understand it.
I don't know why, because it makes his job harder.
I can hold my tongue no longer. Every time.
I know. I don't want to do it either, man.
Madness.
Oh, God. We'll get to it. Because they do it wrong, too. Interstitial, too. The movie farts wrong. I mean, how do you? All right. We'll get there. Interstitial, too.
If ever a movie shat itself trying to fart, it's this movie. Literally and figuratively.
We watched a movie shit itself trying to fart.
We watched Extreme Shart. Yeah. Day. It's a holiday. Extreme Shart Day.
The preceding podcast was a production of Puzzle and a Thunderstorm, LLC. Copyright 2020. All rights reserved.